Okay, we're on it.
Hey, ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome everyone to the January 14th, 2013 business meeting of the Grocery Township Board of Trustees. Let's begin with the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, we have all members present, and we'll call the meeting over at 7:33. We'll begin with, let's see, we just finished the study session, brought that good discussion number items, and step now to the presentation. Mr. Van Oss. Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Bundy.
We just keep going down the road. This presentation is on.
Is that on?
Okay, this presentation is on our water reliability study that was done. This was presented to us at the last DPS meeting, and I thought it was so important that we should have some type of summarization of it and have it brought up at board meeting just to let everybody know what's going on with our water system. A little background on this. This reliability study is mandated by the MDEQ, that's the State of Michigan Department of Environmental Quality. They of course don't fund it. They ask us to do. They tell us to do it and don't give us any money to do it. The study is done. It's important as we go through this, and our engineers, Steve Ohio, and
Kevin.
I knew it was a K. The study is done based on the MDEQ criteria, so the idea of the report is to meet their needs. It's not necessarily what we, the township, want to do. So just keep that in mind. And with that, I'll turn it over to Ohio and Kevin. Thanks for coming today, by the way.
Thank you. Good evening. You pretty much summarized everything we're going to have as a prelude. Yes, the EQ did require the township to perform a reliability study on the water system. The Department of Public Services did request from us to prepare it, and we did. And that's, again, to stay compliant with their Public Act 399. As you also stated, that this study only addresses the EQ minimum requirements to stay compliant. It does not address the capital improvement projects that the DPS is considering. On the other hand, it doesn't mean that capital improvement plans don't include these minimum requirements that DEQ is requiring. With me tonight is Kevin Cook. He's our staff engineer that prepared the study. He'll be making a presentation. At the conclusion, we'll be addressing any questions you may have. Thank you. Kevin.
Thank you, Sahil. My name is Kevin Cook. I appreciate you guys having me here tonight. The report itself was basically most of what was done in 2010. We updated the project in November of 2012 from the EPS Commission. And the full report is about 40 pages, has a lot more details. So my presentation tonight, I'm just going to kind of hit on some of the bigger points and how we came up with some of the models, what figures we came up with, excuse me, and what we're going to do to address them in the future. There are plans to address them in the future. Excuse me, we got a little bit of cold, so I'm going to have to do it here. Okay. So the scope of the report was basically just a general outlines, the introduction, the development of the model, the water distribution system evaluation, system improvement recommendations, improvement costs, summary, and at the end, if you guys have any questions, we'll be more than happy to answer them for you. Okay, the master plan involved the following steps. The first of all was the AutoCAD has a version of WaterCAD. Basically, it's a computer model. You put all your pipes, in the township in to scale, put the sizes, put out the hydrants, valves, elevations of the pipe, and that was done using existing rose seal master outliner water main. We verified some of the pipes using some field verification and discussions with Barry and his people. The second thing we had to do was establish the water supply and lands in the model network. Basically, an average day gross seal is supplied about 1.34 million gallons of water. So for the modeling standpoint, it's very important, where does the demand come from? Because if you take demand out of the system, it decreases pressure. So basically, we're using land use, depending on if it's commercial, residential, the density of said locations, the demand for the water, that 1.34 million gallons was spread out over the township, obviously concentrated areas of high population and density. The third thing that we did was conduct fuel hydrant flow tests to collect the data for calibrating the model network. So what happens is, you got what happens in the field and you got what your model gives you. So we put anything in the computer, ran the models, then what we did is compare them to what was happening actually in the field. So they're never going to be exactly the same, but you take the field conditions and you adjust the model distribution network itself to meet up and match as close as you can what the field pressure flows that we observed in the field. So a lot of that has to do with the age of the pipes. There's friction in the pipes, the age, and a lot of buildup. So what you do, the model starts, okay, these pipes are clean. Why is the field needing what's happening in the model? So you can adjust. Elevation is another issue. The higher the elevation, the lower pressure you have. So there's certain things you can do to actually get the two equalized so you got a good system to go off with. Fourth thing is calibrate the model network to reflect observed distribution conditions, which basically touches on what I just discussed. And then the final thing would be the recommended system improvements for gross seal. Gross seal has approximately 75 miles of water main. I set up a table that shows, based on diameter, the percentages. Most of it, 43% is 8 inch, 20% 12. And a big issue here, which is going to really impact how we move forward in the future, there's a lot of 6-inch pipe, which is 26%. Once the 6-inch diameter mains are put in the 20s, 30s, and 40s, so it's not just the size, it's the age of the 6-inch pipe itself. So basically, this just gives you an idea of what's in the ground and how much, probably there's 75 miles of pipe in the ground. That's pretty accurate. So the next slide will just show basically based on color. It's what size of pipe material is in the ground. You can see the majority of it is the red is the 8-inch and the blue is the 12, the majority of it. But I want to really point out and highlight the yellow, which is the 6-inch pipe that's existing in the ground as of today. And you can see most of it is in the older neighborhoods. Some of the original developments were built using the 6-inch, so that just gives an idea. The next slide goes to the south side of the island. You can really see, especially South Point, Elmar, that area there, has a lot of 6-inch new ground, and then the area is just the north side of the ground. Okay, the DEQ basically requires different scenarios for running the model. And this is all based on how much water is being supplied. You have average day conditions, maximum day conditions, and maximum hour conditions. Within the report itself, there's a lot more detail. Basically, I had to run model calibrations for each one of these conditions. So the average day for gross seal over 2005 to 2011 was 1.34 million gallons. The maximum day conditions were about 2.5 million gallons a day. And the maximum hour condition works out to be 4 million gallons a day. Obviously, the maximum days are higher during your summer months with irrigation is when your higher days are going to be your highest hour, which you can't. Basically, we use DWSD. They got a spreadsheet. You can see per hour how much water that gross seal is using at any given time. So what happens is during the summer, especially early in the morning, when the sprinklers are running, people are getting ready for work. That's why you're seeing that almost 2.5 times on a maximum hourly compared to average days. So it's a lot of water. And the use is based on, okay, what happens if you play, you think, why do you need to do the maximum hour? Well, if you had a fire and you needed to get water supply with decent pressure, they want to see, okay, how is that going to affect the overall system? So. And the next page, which I brought this up earlier, this is where the alleys come in. You'll see it's fed by two different points, the county bridge and the toll bridge. Each, there's a meter at each connection based on DWSD. So this gives you an idea of over the years, MDQ just didn't want to pick one year, but I'd like to see at least a five-year average. And since we started a couple years ago on this, we went a little bit farther back than what we needed to. You can see 2005 was for average, max, and hourly was by far the highest. And then a hot summer, there's a lot of development going on at the time, a lot of water in the grass, a lot of houses being built. Everybody affects what's going on. You can see another connection system here too, is that for an average day, the toll bridge supplies more water than the county bridge. And when you get a peaking demand or a high water use factor, it flips. The county bridge actually provides more. So it has to do with the golf courses, some big laps down in the south end, more irrigation. So the amount of water feed varies through each point. Okay, again, I mentioned this earlier, we got the hydrant flow test performed in 19 locations based on critical pressure zones. Basically, they're distributed throughout the island. Again, the hydrant pressures will compare to the computer model pressures, and the computer model is calibrated to match the fuel measurements. So what happens for the fuel test, you pick up, open a hydrant, full flow like you're having a fire, and then you test the pressure, just that hydrant and how it affects the area surrounding that. So if you have a fire, if you're trying to fire that 1,200 gallons a minute, what DQ likes to see is they want to see that when you've got that hydrant open, that you still have sufficient pressure to fight another fire, to provide adequate water service pressure for people who, just to keep the residents happy, because if you're fighting fire and all the water pressure drops, you're going to have problems, and you got to be able to fight two fires at one time. So some of that comes into play there. And again, these are DQ requirements. Some fire departments have their own requirements that are similar, but for all nonsense, this was MDEQ mandated, that's how we came up with that. Okay, again, touch on this model approach. DEQ requirements that we see in the minute, 1,200 gallons a minute. For a minimum pressure of 20 psi in the system, that's your residual pressure. So when you open the hydrant, they want to see that you have 1,200 psi and the surrounding area doesn't drop below 20 psi. That's the part of the fires. And then on an average, taking out the fire flow, you want to make sure their minimum requirement for pressure is 50 psi for the maximum day periods. Again, that's just to keep sufficient pressure for your homes and be able to maintain the motion normally. That number there, you'll see vary from state to state, but they're starting at 50 psi for that. So the model itself was based, all the input, everything we did is based on, they want to know that they meet that Gros Seals water system meets the two requirements for pressure and for flow. So the next slide, I'll touch on the same thing there again. And the next slide will show the locations. We ran the model, compared to the field, we had adjusted it, and then running on maximum day, were areas within Gros Seal not meet the 1,200 gallon per minute fire flow at 20 psi residual. The map itself, you got to feel free to stop here. And this is how you get one kind of stuff. So if you got any questions, okay. And the red, those nodes that you see are actually very, the round circles themselves are color coordinated. Red is 1199 or less. That means it doesn't need to meet your requirements. The blues are 1,200 to 1,500 psi. The greens are 1,500 to 25 psi. Excuse me. And the blues, dark blues, are 25 gallons per minute. So you can see that Gros Seal does have a very strong water system. There are certain areas that need to be addressed that are not addressed. 8 to 6 inch pipes. So being far and far north end with the old 6 inch pipes, there's been some improvements to that area, but it has not been increased in size, so there's some improvements that need to be done there. And the blue lines are 12 inch, so some of that has been done. But it's kind of spotty throughout the island, but it's concentrated on the north, the south, and then some of the middle areas that aren't sufficient to have real old 6 inch lanes. And we'll go to the south end of the island. I'm going to go to the port, saw 6 inch lanes through there. Years ago, that's a dead end system. They see that one feed, you know, it doesn't move through, so that's a really a high prioritized area that the DEQ is going to be looking at. And then there are certain areas within the middle of the island also that a lot of those you can see are on dead ends, and then along, let me go back to Park Lane, I'm sorry. Park Lane has some long dead ends where you see the red notes up top coming off, and then there's a few other scattered ones, but like I said, most of them are, you can see basically where there's 6 inch pipe and there's dead ends that there's issues in.
My house, for example.
Yeah. And some, there's going to be other issues too. Some of the field tests you'll see in the report, they don't have, there's some old mains that have a lot of breaks that have been fixed. So it kind of gets hard to model those, and some of the differences are hard to come close together. But in general, and for the report, these are the areas here. So we ran the model. The model is identified trouble spots in my township that need to be addressed. So at this point, we're looking, okay, what do we need to do to recommend improvements that will meet the NDEQ requirements? Most of the system performs within the criteria for average daily demands and maximum daily demands are areas that need to be upsized to meet the 1,200 gallon per minute fire flows. There are other areas that need to be looped to eliminate dead ends and improve flow, especially along Park Lane and some of the cul-de-sacs in the township. Which brings us to the next map for improvements. Okay, so we didn't have the pressure and flows at these areas. So we started upsizing using the computer model, saying what do you need to do, improvements are required for the township to get their water distribution system up to the minimum DEQ requirements. On the north end of the island, this map is color-coded. The blues are removed and replaced with 12-inch water main. The red is removed and replaced with 8-inch water main. The darker it's came out here flat, but there's some cover areas, especially on Park Lane, that need to be looped. Basically, you got two dead ends, and you want to loop to get better fire, the water's going to be tight, to get better pressure. So, I was at the north side again, Park Lane, up bridge, there's some old 6 inch, so we'd recommend putting in 12 inch to replace all that 6 inch. There's nothing you can see here that say, okay, you put it at 8 inch 10 years ago, you need outside it to an 8 inch. Basically, it all goes back to upsizing some older mains. Just want to bring that up. And then some smaller areas of red. There's still be some charts following this that have a little bit more detail on exactly the lengths and costs associated with. On the south side of the island, again, Wilbur, South Point, there's a couple of other, apologize, I don't remember the road names there, but there are some, you can see small pieces of 6-inch that need to be upgraded to 8. And basically almost all the development in the Rumbrover and South Point will have to be, we're proposing an upgrade to 8-inch models, so that'll take care of the flows to that area. So looking at it, I mean, between the two, it doesn't seem like there's a lot there, but when you go through, the next chart will show a list of actual roads, locations, proposed improvements, what the proposed diameter of the main will be, approximate length, and estimated costs. So basically, there's two charts before that I covered for charts for sizing. These we've gone through, okay, we did this much pipe, we did an estimate on each run coming through, and some highlight areas that, I mean, we've looked at before, some of you may know, especially tied to West River, East River, upsizing the 6 to 12. And another big area would be woods between East Jackson and Park Lane. Woodcrest between H.L. Jackson, Park Lane. There's another couple big pieces by Dallas from Park Lane through the loop. That's that dead end square loop there. And just some odds and ends, 500 feet, 1,000 feet, but it all adds up. So the approximate total length of main meet, again, this is to meet MDEQ minimum requirements. We're estimating out of 57,660 feet at an estimated cost of $8,879,000.
Is that all?
Yeah.
It's about 15% of our...
So in summary, we're looking at overall the system is considered reliable. The current areas that need to be upgraded. 57,000 feet again, the existing water main needs to be upsized and looped. And above and beyond that, just to highlight it, there's an additional 56,000 feet of 6-inch that is there. Water-wise, it meets the conditions, but the condition of a pipe is a different, something else we discussed, at a different time. And there's no way to gradually increase PBR settings at the total in county limits from 57 to 59 PSI, which is easier said than done when you got a lot of old pipe in the system. So it can cause some problems, but that is one of the recommendations also. So at this point, there's a lot of stuff. Like I said, this all comes back to this a lot more detailed report that we performed. So we kind of a lot more nitty-gritty in the report than here, but I just wanted to give you an overall view of how we came up with the model and what we recommended to improve the system.
Kevin, how old are the main lines at the Cummings Bridge and the Toll Bridge coming over, bringing our water over? Do you know if Anderson Hines in there?
The Toll Bridge main was put for the purpose of supplying the army base. I think it's 1943 vintage, so it's pretty old. We have some concerns about it because it does cross the river and it doesn't have that much berry cover on it underneath the river. It does have some problems along the Meridian Road. We've experienced some breaks for the past few years on it. So it is a main that overall from across the river down to Glor Road that may be in consideration for future capital improvement plans. The one on the county bridge, it's about, I'm going to guess about 30 years old. It's much newer pipe, 24-inch pipe. It comes from Trenton. It is a little bit more sturdy. It's a lock joint pipe, tough line. And it was buried in a new groove in the rock, so it does have some cover on it. So it's a bit more reliable. It doesn't need any improvements in the near future. It should last 2 more years, about 20, 30 more years before we have to address it.
All of these projected costs part of the capital improvement plan within the DPS, I'm sure.
We had a pretty aggressive capital improvement plan back in 2000. All of these were on schedules to be done and completed almost everything. Then the DEQ came in and decided that our sewer system was going to take priority to the tune of $50 million. So most of our efforts from 2000 2006 or 7, 8, were concentrated with all of our capital improvement costs. All of our mining capabilities was pretty much driven to the sewer project and sewer rehab. That is really what a big hole in our ability to move forward with capital improvement projects for the water. We have several capital improvement projects in place. We have some bonding money in place currently. And now it's just a matter of setting priorities as to which way we're going to go. But until our capital improvement bond with the sewer system starts to diminish a little bit, we are kind of hands tied as to how much money we can commit. because of our ability to bond, because of our extreme outlay of bond money for the sewer project. Now, that doesn't mean that the sewer project or the sewers in the township probably don't have an equal number to it. I'm sure if you do a reliability study on the sewer lines in the township, we're going to see some big numbers there. I'm doing it now with the DPS and with this board and future boards, simply because of the amount of debt. We manage our funds to the best of our ability without crushing the township in debt, or without crushing the township in water bills and sewer bills that we can't pay. I mean, you still need to use and receive water and process your sewage at a reasonable rate, an acceptable rate. So it's kind of a balancing act, and we're several years from getting it in order now because of the $50 million bond that we've already dealt with. I'm not saying it's impossible. I'm not saying we won't maintain it. We will do that whenever possible. We're getting any road projects. We'll upgrade as we go along. But I don't foresee any major sewer or water rehabs in the near future because we just don't have the funding for it without, again, putting a tremendous stress on the water bills, the sewer bills.
Or the village issues.
Or the village issues. So it's not a good scenario. The pipes that we've got are getting us through. I'm really reluctant to think that we want to go forward with increasing pressures. This place is going to look like a sprinkler if we do. I mean, we're already having enough trouble with water main breaks as it is.
I mean, we get a 10-pound surge any given time, we could bust 5 or 6 mains here on the island. So that's probably not the answer. The answer will be to move forward at a cautious pace and bond it when we can and get it done when we can. But it's not going to be a quick project. I don't see it that way anyway.
Is this list in any ranking order at all, based on priority or anything? No?
We all have Ann's mic tonight. Mr. Ranker.
Question I have is, you know, I alluded to the fact that there's nothing going to happen fast, but what kind of constraints are the DEQ going to put on us when they see the summary of this?
They haven't mandated these repairs yet. They like to see some projects go through to show good faith effort toward meeting their compliance requirements. So to answer you, we have to collect $1 million within the next 5 years. The answer is no. As long as they see some good faith effort and to replacing some sections here and there just to keep the system going. Again, Gross Hill doesn't have a major concern of reliability except in some of these areas. That doesn't mean you can't fight fires, you still can't fight fires. But again, these are areas that eventually you have to address and replace. The pace of them can be addressed next time we meet with Christine Donaldson from the EPU, and that she has a report, she's aware of it, she hasn't issued any requirements or mandates yet to undertake any of these projects. So we're going to try to pace ourselves. Like Ted mentioned, your funds are limited, so you don't want to go ahead and start undertaking these and overtaxing the citizens with extreme high rates. But we work with them, and I'm sure they work with us, hopefully.
Anything else from the board?
I just want to make one more comment. Currently, under the current administrations, it's not just Gross Hill that is having infrastructure problems throughout the United States. The whole United States is having infrastructure problems. And it is our hope and our desire going forward that at some point in time, funds will become available through the federal government. I know that's a long shot, but there is a possibility that they may designate funds to address just these issues. And obviously, even if it becomes a participating grant by the community where they'll put up some money, we'll put up some money, we might at some point in time, and I'm hoping in the very near future, I'm hoping under this current administration, however, I doubt it very much, but I'm hoping that some funds will become available and we can get a little more aggressive on the policies. But until such time that we do that, you have to remember that we're under some terrific debt restraints right now, and I don't see that changing unless we do get some relief from the government. state government, federal government, or somebody. We're hoping that that will happen. We'll politic and we'll go after the state and local officials to try to give us some aid, but it will have to be a mandate, I believe, that will be a federal mandate that everybody gets to share in those funds. And hopefully those funds will become available. Like I say, under the current administration, I just don't know if it's going to happen.
Other comments thank you, Mr. Vanas. Other comments from the board? Open up to questions from the public. Mr. Clark.
Woody Clark, Park Lane.
Did you take out the equation for the country clubs? If you're saving the water from the spray the stuff on the land from the water, they don't go through a pipe. They go through a pipe and not through the city water. Was that taken out of it?
Yes, for irrigation along East and West River.
Was taken out of the equation?
Yeah, it's hard to tell exactly how much because there wasn't enough to make a difference.
So you could go to their water. If we have a fire, we can use their water? I mean, the water in the river?
We can't.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah. Okay. Just want to make sure. Well, thank you.
Any other questions, comments? We're seeing the range regarding this water rate study. That being said,
nice job, Sohail.
Thank you. Thank you.
In the future, if you think of any questions that you need to answer tonight, please let us know by email or by phone call. We're available if you want to send any questions you may have. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Sohail. Kevin? All right, that is tonight's presentation. Again, thanks. Very, very informative. It's what we do with your money, among other things. At this point, we will consider additions or deletions to the agenda, and I'm going to move that we delete action item 10 from the agenda.
Second.
Okay, Mr. Vanas was first, so second by Mr. Vanas. Any discussion among the board? Okay, with none offered, those in favor of removing action item 10 from the action items, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? None offered. Please remove action item 10. Other additions, deletions to the agenda?
Yeah, Mr. Supervisor, I'd like to make a motion to add to our closed session, which is going to be on labor negotiations, discussion on the ACO, the administrative consent order by the DEQ.
Okay, moved by Treasurer Van Os.
Seconded
by Clerk Ranka to add the administrative consent order and the legal work we're doing on the administrative consent order to the closed session after the public meeting. Discussion among the board? Okay, with none offered, those in favor of adding the administrative consent order or legal discussions to the closed session, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That will be added to the closed session after we complete the business in the open session. Other additions, deletions to the agenda? Okay, with none offered, I will entertain a motion to approve the agenda as amended. Moved by Mr. Budney.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Trustee Posiask. Those in favor of the amended agenda, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? None offered. The agenda is so amended. The consent agenda.
I'd like to make a motion to approve consent agenda 13-001, which is the approval of the minutes of the December 10th, 2012 regular meeting, the check register dated December 18th, 2012, and the check register dated January 11th, 2013.
Okay, I have the motion by Treasurer Van Os.
Second.
Seconded by Clerk Ranka. Any inputs, discussion from the board? With none offered, those in favor of approving the consent agenda as published, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? None offered. The consent agenda stands approved. We're moving to action items. Here's my stack. Okay, I'll introduce the first move that Goshen Township Board approve the appointments of Julia Roscoe and Irma Simcoe to the Island Beautification Committee for a term length January 14, 2013 to March 31, 2016, based upon the recommendation of the Island Beautification Committee.
Support.
Seconded by Treasurer Van Ass, thank you. Discussion among the board? All right, with none offered, any discussion among the public present? With none offered, then, those in favor of appointing Julia Roscoe and Irma Simcoe to the Island Beautification Committee for the mentioned terms, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? None offered? Ms. Roscoe and Ms. Simcoe, welcome aboard. Thank you for volunteering. Action item number two, Board of Review appointments. This one's mine also. I move that the Township Board approve the reappointments of Mr. Richard Nielsen, Ms. Shelley Smitke, and Mr. William Mead, and Mr. Timothy Walker as an alternate to the Grocey Hill Township Board of Review for the term length of January 1st, 2013 to December 31st, 2014. Seconded by Treasurer Van Ass. The history behind this, Mr. Nielsen, Ms. Schmidtke, and Mr. Walker, Mr. Mead wish to continue to serve on the Board of Review. Mr. Walker serves on the Board of Review as an alternate. It's a mandatory position. The Board of Review meets in March to hear assessment appeals and in July and December for technical corrections to the assessment role. It is the thankless of thankless jobs. Any discussion among the board on these appointments, recommended appointments? None offered, those in from the public present on these appointments. With none offered, those in favor of approving supervisors' reappointments of Richard Nielsen, Shelley Schmidtke, William Mead, and Timothy Walker to the Grocey Hill Township Board of Review for the mentioned term length, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? None offered. Again, a thankless job, and Tim, thanks for volunteering for one more term. Board of Review, I'm sorry. I would move that the Grocey Hill Township Board of Trustees resolve to adapt the 2013 Board of Review Income and Asset Threshold Guidelines.
Support.
Seconded by Treasurer Van Ass. Board of Review Income Threshold Guidelines, we do give a consideration for income hardships, but we have to approve the threshold. The numbers are given by the state, and I guess I'll just have to read the resolution. Whereas the homestead of person or persons who, in the judgment of the Board of Review, by reason of poverty, that was what I was looking for, poverty exemption, are unable to contribute to the public charges, is eligible for exemption in whole or part from taxation under the General Property Tax. And whereas Township Board of Trustees is required by Section 7U, the General Property Tax Act, Public Act 206 of 1893, and that's Michigan Compiled Laws 211.7U, uniform, to adopt guidelines for poverty exemptions. Now therefore be it resolved, pursuant to Michigan Compiled Law 211.7U, that the Township of Grocey Hill, Wayne County, Michigan, adopts the following guidelines for the Board of Review to implement in 2013, which shall include, but not be limited to, the specific income and asset levels of the claimant and all persons residing in the household, including any property tax credit returns filed in the current or immediately preceding year. Item Alpha, 2013 Grocey Hill Township Poverty Guidelines. Size of family unit, one person, $21,000. Two persons, $23,000. Three persons, $25,000. Four persons, $27,000. Five persons, $29,000. Six persons, $31,000. Seven persons, $34,930. Eight persons, $38,890. And for each additional household member, add $3,960. Item B, homeowners and all household members with liquid assets, defined as anything readily converted to cash in excess of $57,000, shall not be eligible for a poverty exemption. Item C, the completion of the Grocey Hill, of the Township of Grocey Hill 2013 application for hardship exemption. Be it also resolved
That the Board of Review shall follow the above stated policy and state guidelines for the year 2013 in granting or denying an exemption unless the Board of Review determines there are substantial and compelling reasons why there should be a deviation from the policy and/or township and state guidelines, and these are communicated in writing to the claimant. That is the resolution. Some background. The history purpose, the Board of Review must adopt the federal poverty income standards as of the December 31st, 2012 for use in setting poverty exemption guidelines for 2013 assessments as adopted by the state of Michigan unless the Township Board adopts new guidelines. The Board of Review feels the federal guidelines are too low and have selected guidelines more in line with Grosseal Township property values. A hardship application is required to be completed, and 2012 tax forms for all household members must be submitted to be considered for hardship exemption. Implementation schedule will be for Board of Review use in reviewing low-income appeals for the 2013 tax year. That's it in a nutshell. And that is, I mean, that is a right that the residents have to appeal on, among other reasons, on the poverty exemption. Discussion among the board. Discussion among the public present. With none offered, those in favor of approving the resolution as read, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? None offered? Those are, we hereby adopt Grosseal's Township Poverty Guidelines for Property Tax Review. Thank you. Okay, this will be my last one. I would move that the Grosseal Township Board of Trustees approve the, and it's by resolution again, the mail-in appeals for Grosseal resident.
Support.
Second again by Treasurer Van Os. Thank you. I'll read the resolution. Whereas the Michigan law allows the governing body of a township to permit resident taxpayers to file a protest to the Board of Review in writing without a personal appearance, and whereas some residents have difficulty attending scheduled March Board of Review sessions in person, and whereas the intent of the Board of Review is to make tax appeals as accommodating as possible to as many residents taxpayers as possible, now therefore be it resolved, the Grosseal Township Board of Trustees does hereby authorize township residents or their representatives to appeal their property taxes to the 2013 March Board of Review in writing without a personal appearance. The background is, again, the governing body may by resolution permit resident taxpayers to file a protest to the Board of Review in writing without a personal appearance. Though the Board of Review makes very liberal appointment days and times, some residents still find it difficult to attend due to conflicts with their daily schedules. If the resolution is adopted to allow residents to file protests in writing, it must be noted in the assessment change notice. In the assessment change notice required, Michigan Compile Law 211.24C, and in each notice or publication of the meeting of the Board of Review. Questions from the board? Comments? Questions, comments from the public present on mailing in your appeal to Board of Review? All right, with none offered, those in favor of approving the resolution as read to allow for bail-in appeals to property taxation, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? You are hereby allowed to mail in your petition for tax relief. Action item number five. Mr. Treasurer.
I'd like to make a motion to accept the resignation from the Airport Commerce Park and Commission Brownfield Authority of Mr. Nardoni.
I'll second the motion.
Thank you, Brian. Basically, Joe has been served on the Commerce Park Commission for a number of years. I've only recently been appointed as liaison to that. From everything I've heard, I haven't had the opportunity of meeting Mr. Nardoni myself, but he's going to be greatly missed on this commission. I understand he took a job that was possibly a conflict of interest. We told him if there's a job change, we're going to be knocking on his door.
Very good. Are there comments from the board on Mr. Nardoni's resignation from the Airfield Commerce Park Commission? From the public present? All right, with none offered, those in favor of accepting with regret the resignation of Mr. Joseph R. Dardoni from the Air Force Comer Park Commission and Brownfield Authority. Please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? None offered. Mr. Nardoni, thank you for your service. Door is still open. Action item number six.
Mr. Chair.
Ms. Hanson.
This action item is to recommend, based on the recommendation of the Bicycle and Pedestrian Advisory Commission, the Groseal Township Board of Trustees to approve participation in a promoting active communities program. This is a...
Second.
Thank you. Seconded by someone who put a lot of work into it, too. We have in our audience Alan Velikat, Brian Pollock, sitting in the back row there. Two hardworking guys, very passionate about this program. I have to mention Gene Fiegel, Aaron Himmelsbach, and Rob Albert. And Eric, I'm still having a hard time catching up with these guys. They have covered a lot of ground. This program is a wonderful program to promote us and make us unique. It is going to cost the taxpayers of Groseal Township nothing. There is a lot of input that needs to be done by several people in the township. It's a 14-step assessment. But those two fellows in back are here to answer any questions either during, now, or after the presentation. But I would really, really much recommend that this be adopted as an action item. It'll make Groseal look real good in the eyes of people who work active and athletic.
What is the presentation tomorrow evening? Am I mixing that with some other?
Gentlemen, would you like to come up
please,
and answer questions?
Please enlighten us as to what we can do for you and where we're going with the promoting physically active communities.
Well, thank you for having us tonight. And we do have a study session tomorrow evening, 7:30 in the bottom conference room. That'll be a study session specifically about our assessment areas, things that we've been finding as far as physical conditions, as well as working a little bit more on this packet, such approved. But there wasn't a formal presentation tomorrow. there wasn't.
Could I ask a question? But can you just give us kind of an overview of what this pack is, so that... I said a quick
quote. Anyway, I was saying, the PAC program is just a self-assessment program. We're going to try to complete, once we're completed, we'll be rated both state and nationally. And then we'll turn around and use it as a tool. We can use the tool in many different ways, for recognition, for planning, for partnerships. We can co-mingle with a lot of other communities and get great information from them. But just public awareness is great, and that supports the program, marketing, funding. We can rely on it, and we can use it as a marketing tool to draw people to the island. And the best part is it's free.
Just time.
Well, we're going to ask you to apply a little bit of time to this. We've been initially reviewing the PAC program, and we've answered about 40% of it without any effort and assistance from anybody in the township. We don't know how long it'll take. It could take just minutes. It could take hours. It's moving a lot faster than we thought. So we're going to ask each department head to get a look-see at their particular area of interest. They may be able to answer these questions pretty fast. They may have to do a little bit of research. We don't anticipate more than maybe several hours on each category.
What never ceases to amaze me is you've got two people standing up here as volunteers. I can't even imagine how much time you've already put into this. And you said, well, it's going to take us any time.
It's a worthy cause. And we'd like to take a minute to and also thank Carol Knopf. She puts a lot of time in, makes it easy on us, does a lot of our footwork for us. When we need something copied or done, she has it ready for us to go. We don't have to spend a lot of time on that. And we need to stop and really thank her for her time.
Great.
Adam?
Mr. President,
the
The thing that's important is tomorrow night is an open study session. If there are people out here who are curious, or who want to know what this is all about in a little bit more detail, we invite you to come down and sit with us. I'm going to be in there learning just as much as those people that will sit with us, and we're going to really take this a step forward. We've all talked for how many years about how important it is to draw people to go see us, and how important it is to show how unique we are. This could make us very, very attractive to those who are physical fitness buffs, the bikers, the runners, and I don't think we are known very well. We are kind of a best-kept secret. We need to get our flag up.
Well, certainly.
Thank you.
Mr. Bailey.
Yeah, I just want to go over something real quick with you. You say it's no cost to the township for this. Is that now and in the future? I mean, by adopting this, we're not down the road tying us into any project to do it.
No, I should have rephrased that as free and non-binding. You guys love that. Non-binding. So we have no commitment to this. We can do it annually, and to whatever extent we choose to do it.
Thanks, sir.
The main plan is to have a baseline assessment of where we're at, which we know that, at least anecdotally, that there's a lot of things going for Grozillo, so we're hoping that we can get award just from that alone. But from this point, it'd be a sort of a launching pad for, once we get the survey back, we can find which areas, according to this survey, that they say we might, want to improve, and then we make that decision. Is this something that we want to, go ahead with? Does it make sense to do this now? Does it make sense to do this 10 years from now? But, it's getting that baseline assessment, and then figuring out how do we, the things that we choose to do, how are we going to implement them in the future? Is that going to be a part of a recreation master plan update? Do we use something when we do a master plan update or zoning ordinances? Is it something that we work together with the schools, or is it something with civic organizations? There's a lot of different opportunities out there, but getting that baseline so that way we can do proper planning into the future.
Thank you guys for all the time that you spent on this.
You just answered a couple questions I had percolating. One other, do we lay this assessment against the complete streets? It's not a mandate, but the complete streets guideline, make sure they dovetail, that we are assessing, while doing this, do we assess that ourselves against complete streets? Or is that even taken into consideration?
Part of this, it's keeping in the spirit with complete streets, and the legislation that was passed for complete streets, it doesn't bind us to anything. Mm-hmm. That's something that we choose to do, and it's more of a planning process working with the road agencies, as well as if we decide to adopt more complete streets policies at a local level. So, for example, maybe in the spirit of complete streets as well as this PAC, we identify what are the critical routes for bicycle and pedestrian travel that need to be plowed first during an ice storm, because their senior housing, these people need to get to the store in order to get their medications or to go to the restaurants, etc. But I mean, that could be something that comes out of this that we decide to do in the future. So they're in some ways, they're two separate processes, but they complement each other very well.
Thank you.
Other comments from the board?
Just a minute. Mr. Supervisor, just a really quick thanks again, Brian, for your leadership on the Bicycle and Pedestrian Commission Advisory Commission. Alan, thanks for taking the PAC and running with it, and Wally for being the liaison. I think the PAC is, it's something that's new to us, but I think that it is an excellent opportunity for us to do a self-assessment that's more than just a self-assessment, but one that will resonate within the state of Michigan, which will open up potentially grant opportunities, funding opportunities, and planning opportunities. So I think it's an excellent tool. It is free, but it will take the time of some of our staff, and I wanted the board to recognize that is the case. I think it's valuable time that will be spent on this, but I do think it's a very worthwhile cause, and I'm happy that we're considering moving forward with it.
Okay. More comments from the board? Comments from the public present? All right, with none offered. Those in favor of Grozillo Township participating in the Promoting Active Communities Program, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? None offered. We will be participating. Thanks, guys.
I'm going to say, I'd like to add, echoing Wally's invitation. All of our study sessions, as well as our meetings, are open to the public. We encourage anyone to come down, as well as we do have a Gmail email address. So if you guys can't make it, if anyone cannot make it down, they feel free to contact us at gibikeped@gmail.com. As well as we do have a Facebook page that's unofficial, you know, it's not specifically tied to the township or the commission, but, you know, it's another way to communicate information about bicycle pedestrian travel, and that's Groziel Walks and Bikes. So thank you.
Thank you. And thank you, Jens. Well, let's see, move to action item number 7, the Island Fest Carnival contract.
Yep, Mr. Mr. Supervisor, I'd like to recommend to the Groziel Township Board that we grant approval to the Festival Commission to contract Skirbeck Brothers Shows Incorporated to operate a carnival during Island Fest from the dates of Friday, May 31st, 2013, through Sunday, June 2nd, 2013.
Okay, looking for support. All right, seconded by Treasurer Van Os. You're going to turn it over to, did I overstep?
No. I don't know. No. Okay, I didn't know.
I just grab a, you know, it's not my good ears. Okay. The first one I hear, jet engines. I guess you'll turn over the explanation to our recreation manager, Mr. Ernie.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Today I provided another document, the contract to you. You had it on your desk there. And I'm still receiving some information on insurance items and also from the township attorney. And let me just go over that real briefly with you. The first paragraph, you'll notice this agreement. We had Groziel Township and Skirbeck Brothers. It was Groziel Festival Commission. Our attorney thought it would be better to be the overall township. And then if you go down below note, it said Groziel Festival Commission. There we went with Groziel Township. And then throughout the rest of the document, you'll see the Festival Commission working with Skirbeck. Another change was in the blue paragraph about almost to the end there, I added the word "be" as after they looked it over, the insurance carriers thought that should add that "shall be dispersed as set forth above." It's in that blue paragraph there. And then the other changes were on the second page under rules and regulations. We're just trying to get a little more coverage. We have some solid coverage. But they know the carnivals. They're pretty active. It involves equipment. And our plan is to provide better overall coverage. And that's what we'd like to submit to Skirbeck as part of the contract. And then a little more definition on additional insured. We added, along with the township and the Groziel Township Festival Commission, we added the Groziel Airport Commerce Park Commission and the Groziel Airport Advisory Committee. Those were only changes. And both the attorney and the insurance carrier have commented on it and give it their blessing.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Rooney. Questions, comments from the board?
Thank you, Mr. Supervisor. I think it's just important to recognize that this is a primary funding source for the carnival. Last year, it says that their total gross was $52,000. They give us 20%. Of rides plus a flat rate on some concession space. So basically they brought in a little over $11,000 to the township last year. So it's just I think important to note to the community. They say why do we have the carnival there? Well, they provide a lot of money for the township and to help the whole Island Fest.
Appreciate you pointing that out. I also wanted to add that they received the Circle of Excellence Award. Each year a third party independent auditor looks at 43 aspects of outdoor amusement operations, and Skirbeck received the Circle of Excellence. There were only 20 in North America, and there's several hundred carnival operators. And the commission's been pretty strong, has a strong feeling about keeping Skirbeck. They've been family-owned for 150 years. They references are excellent, state of Michigan licensing compliance. Wayne County has never really had any problems with the food concessions that they've gone through. Great reviews from the township fire marshal in the past. Clean appearance, their staff and rides, and that's three of the big areas under the circle of excellence of safety, cleanliness, and quality of equipment. They're excellent at cleanup. Like Eric said, they have they really go into the community and help promote fundraising within the community. So just wanted to add that.
Okay. Other questions, comments from the board? Mr. Malvesto.
Yes, I am. Can you see if the schedule just limited to like 5 degrees warmer this year?
Yeah.
Not quite as warm as 2 years ago, but just a little bit warmer than last year.
We've had a few tornadoes around us, a few of the years, yeah. Part of Highland Fest.
Other questions, comments, or requests from the board? From the public present? All right, with none offered, those in favor of allowing the festival commission, or approving the festival commission's contracting with Skirvick Brothers Shows to operate a carnival during Island Fest, and the dates are May 31st, 2013 through Sunday, June 2nd, 2013, signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed?
None offered, so go with the contract. All right, moving along, let's see, action item number, wastewater treatment plant security cameras, Mr. Budney.
Mr. Supervisor, I'd like to make a motion based on the recommendation of the DPS Commission to award bid to Mid-State Security, which was the lowest bid, in the amount of $19,993 for installation of IP-based network surveillance system utilizing 6 IP cameras and a network video recorder for the wastewater treatment plant. And Barry, I'll let you do the history on
that. Second. Second by Clerk Branca.
And now I'll let Barry.
Mr. Sandbach.
Good evening. Mr. Budney's correct. This is a project that's been on the wastewater treatment plant capital improvements list for quite some time, finally making its way up to this year. Security at the plant has always been one of our major concerns. Over the last several years, we have had a few intrusions. Sometimes they took place right during business hours where you look over your shoulder and somebody stared at Joe in the plant. It's an area in our community that needs to have rather tight security for many reasons. So at this particular time, we did well for bids. We received two. This company, Mid-States, was a little bitter. And as you can see in the packet, one of the pages kind of gives you the coverage that we're going to have there at the onset.
You have that page, Bill. Could you put it on the overhead for the those present net? Then we've got to figure out how to switch that over to overhead. And
that's not going to be something I can do.
There we go.
Well, you're halfway tonight. I got to figure out how to zoom in.
This is the area, the shaded area is what you'll see right now, and that's going to be covered by the bid that's in front of you here. This, and also included in this, is there are security cameras inside of the laboratory building also, which you can't see from this shot. But what we're doing, this system right here is kind of a basic system that we've got started with. Now this system can be expanded. It has the capability with what we're purchasing here tonight to add additional cameras down the line if we need it. There's different ways that we can process the information. This system is capable, or it will be set up to store the data for 30 days, and then it starts repeating itself over. This time limit can be adjusted. In fact, I talked to the company the other day because one of the questions came up at the commission on the duration of the time period that we should keep this information. And he said that we could shorten the time frame up if we wanted to, but it would require a little bit lesser equipment as far as database goes. We're better to leave the 30 days because if we go to 7 days or 10 days, the equipment changes. This way, if we stay with the 30-day, we can expand on this in the future readily, where no changes have to be made in the equipment itself.
And Mary, the 30 days, it's a loop, correct?
Yes.
So at the end of the day, the first day drops off.
That's right. And it just keeps repeating itself and lapping over the top of what was there existing. So this is a pretty good system as far as what we've put up for bid. We didn't want to go too elaborate at the beginning. We wanted to get this in place and see how it works. And then, like I said, if we want to expand on it, we can do that pretty readily with this equipment without too much effort.
Mary, the gate.
Yes.
Is that an additional action item that's coming forward?
Yes, and I was just going to mention that. Part of this package that will be coming before the board here probably in the next month or two is a power gate that we're going to put at the plant. Right now it's a manual swing gate. You get out and you take the padlock off, you open the gate stays open while the personnel are working there. At night they close it. We're working on a power gate right now that one of these cameras at that end of the plant will be focused on that gate. Joe in the plant, the wastewater treatment plant manager, will be able to look on his computer monitor when somebody drives up to that gate. That gate will stay closed at all times. There's a device out there for the person who wants to get into the plant. You make contact with Joe in the plant. Joe can open the gate if he sees who he is, or he doesn't have to open the gate, depending. So that's in the works right now, and that'll probably be coming through here probably within the next month or so.
Have a DEQ lock on that.
Yeah. That's a great
Okay, any other comments from the board for Mr. Sedlak? Not offered. Any comments, questions for Mr. Sedlak from the public present? All right, we've been offered. We're in favor of awarding the bid to Vintage Security in the amount of $19,993 for installation of IP-based network surveillance system utilizing six cameras, network video recorder for the wastewater treatment plant. Signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? None offered? Make our plant safe. Thank you. Action item number nine.
Yes, Mr. Supervisor. I'd like to make a motion to support a resolution approving membership and participation in the Downriver Department of Public Works and Services Collaborative and to formally appoint Barry E. Sedlak, DPS Director, as the representative for Groseal Township to the collaborative.
Okay, seconded by Treasurer Van Os.
I guess, Mr. Sedlak?
Well, I was wondering if you want the resolution read.
Yes, and then we'll let him...
Then we'll let him give the history and background on it. That's on the next page for those of you that have the packet. Resolution approving membership and participation in Downriver Department of Public Works/Services Collaborative. Whereas the Township of Groseal is a member of the Downriver Community Conference, a consortium of 20 Downriver communities in Wayne County, whose total population is approximately 500,000, joined in an effort to improve local government and enhance the quality of life for area residents through municipal cooperation. And whereas the Township of Groseal desires to cooperate with the other members of the Downriver Community Conference in issues relating to Department of Public Works Services Collaborative purchasing, information sharing, and mutual aid. And whereas the state of Michigan has initiated legislation to encourage such collaboration among municipal governments. And whereas the various directors of public works and public service departments of the Downriver Community Conference's member municipalities have been meeting and desire to formalize this collaborative through bylaws, which have been adopted by the directors pending approval of membership and participation by each municipality. And whereas those bylaws state, should a DCC member community wish to have a representative on the collaborative, a formal resolution from that member community's governing board should be provided specifically requesting representation along with the name and title of the community's appointed representative and an alternate if desired. Communities may appoint any individual that is directly employed by the by that DCC member community whose job responsibility is the management, administration, or oversight of the community public works services department. And whereas the director of the Township of Groseal's Department of Public Services recommends approval of this resolution and requests formal appointment to the collaborative in accordance with the collaborative bylaws. Now, therefore, it is resolved that this resolution approving membership and participation in the Downriver Department of Public Works Services Collaborative is hereby approved and is presented, and be it further resolved that the Township of Groseal's Director of Public Services is designated as the appointed representative to the collaborative, and its Assistant Director of Public Works be designated as its alternative representative to the collaborative, and be it further resolved, the clerk is directed to transmit a certified copy of this resolution along with the names of the municipality's director of public services to the collaborative and the name of the municipality's assistant director of public services to the director of planning of the Downriver Community Conference. These individuals will have voting rights as collaborative members. The undersigned clerk, et cetera, et cetera. And for those of you here, if you didn't see, there was a change made on the one you originally had. Where it said, be it further resolved, it may have Department of Public Services, that should be director, and the correction was handed to you.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Reddy. Mr. Shadlock, are you going to pick up the presentation from here?
Just a little background about the DCC and how this collaborative came about is back in probably January of 2010, the DCC contacted members of the Department of Public Services in probably a dozen or 14 communities initially. We met over at the DCC building, and we've been meeting there monthly ever since. And one of the first things that we did back in 2010 was we put together a mutual aid agreement for Downriver Department of Public Services, something basically the same as you have through public safety, where each community, if they need assistance from another community, we pick up the telephone, and it gave us the authority to be able to do that when we needed it. And it's worked out very well. There's been times when other communities have needed assistance both ways. We've assisted, they've assisted us. So it's worked out very well. And that was initially what took place and why it took place. But it expanded upon that as time went on. We got to the point where we were collaboratively bidding different products that all 20, we're up to 20 communities now in this consortium. We're now bidding products that all of us use from time to time, and we're getting better prices because we're bidding as a group. A few things that come across mine is coal patch that we have everybody use quite a bit of. We bid that as a lump sum for all 20. Repair clamps for water mains, we touched on that in the earlier presentation. We bid those out annually, and we take a low bid, and we get all of our sleeves from that company, and they do right by us. So there's a couple of things. There's other things that we do also that help reduce costs to the individual community. And this is just another step. Up until this point, since we started, the DCC has been running our meetings themselves. We've had representatives from the DCC that actually basically chair our meetings. It came a point in time, which is now, that we've put together bylaws that now we are going to be conducting our own meetings. We've elected a chair and a co-chair. and this is going to take place, it's supposed to take place at the January meeting, but it'll probably take place in February now. The DCC is still going to be involved. Those people are still going to be there. Sue Pilon is the one that takes our minutes to our meetings and coordinates everything that we do. They just wanted us to take a little bit more active part in the participation part of it, so we're actually going to be conducting our own meetings now from now on, and that's what this bylaws and documentation is all about.
Okay. Questions from the board for Mr. Sadler? Just wanted to mention that an alternate required. Do you think we would want?
Yes, we would probably designate Melinda Benito in my department. She's the assistant. So if I can't make it, she would attend the meetings on my behalf. And she has been listed on there as the alternate actually since it started. Mm-hmm.
Do we need to approve her as alternate?
It's in the resolution.
That's it, okay. That was my question.
No questions. Just a quick general comment and saying, you know, that this is, I think, just one more example of local governments working together to save costs, and this is, you know, a screaming example of it. There are a number of others that we have with the police department, with the mutual aid, with certain dive teams and other task forces. So I'm very, very pleased that we're involved in this.
Barry, just the, you know, the, we've had a rash of water main breaks, especially around the holidays, and right on Meridian Road, around Anderson, I think, there was one, and there was a Riverview truck that was there with our people pretty much all day.
Right, and that's a good example of sharing services. We needed a particular piece of equipment that we don't have. The city of Riverview has that type of equipment. I called them on the telephone, and within 30 minutes, it was on the job. And that's the kind of cooperation that the community share among themselves. But if we have something that someone can use, we readily take care of it, and vice versa. And there was no charge for that. They sent that truck over, and it was there all day, and you won't see a bill for it.
Just have one question. Does this give us another check mark on the governor's dashboard?
I'm doing it.
Yeah. Other questions, comments from the board? Not offered any questions, comments from the public present. With none offered, will vote the Gross Hill Township Board of Trustees approve membership and participation in the Downriver Department of Public Works/Services Collaborative and formally appoint Barry Sunlock, DPS Director, as a representative for Gross Hill Township to the Collaborative. Those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? None offered?
Thank you.
Continue, Barry.
Thanks, Barry.
That will conclude our action items. We'll move on to the clerk's report.
Thank you, Mr. Supervisor. Just a very brief clerk's report tonight. Ms. Smith, Trustee Smith at the last meeting had brought up the fact that we should work together on a recommendation for how we codify the process for approving commission members. So we've been arranging schedules, and we've got a meeting next Monday to get that ironed out. So that will be taking place. And then the rest of my items will be in the discussion item with a proposal for paperless packages.
Thank you, Mr. Acker. Mr. Treasurer.
Thank you. For the month of November, Gross Hill Township had a total of $10,572,469 and change invested in various accounts. These accounts generated interest of $2,976 and change with an average interest rate of 0.25%. Gross Hill winter taxes are due February 14th. Payments are accepted at Township Hall by mail, or at the local branch of Fifth Third and PNC, as well as Metro Shores Credit Union. Taxes can also be paid online using the link in the Treasurer's Office website. There's a convenience fee charge for the official payments company of $3 per e-check payment and 3% fee on the credit card payment. The extension of February 14th due date is available for those who qualify. Just come down to the Treasurer's Office. Winter tax deferments are available at the treasurer's office. Approved deferments will extend the February 14th due date till April 30th, 2013. We are now selling 2013 dog tags. Please provide rabies vaccination when purchasing it for your pet. Cost of the tag is $6 until the end of January. On February 1st, the price goes to $12. There's a complete investment report that's available at the treasurer's office if anybody wants to see it, which gives us all of our investments, where they're at, how they're proceeding with. I have nothing further.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Treasurer. We'll move on to trustee reports. Mr. Bellamy.
Yes, I have nothing to report for DPS. We had no meeting this month. We will have it up in February. ZBA does have a meeting, I believe, next Tuesday. I'm losing track of the 4th and the 3rd, the way the month is going, but the 4th Tuesday is the ZBA meeting, and we have a couple items on there. I would encourage the residents to either stop by or tune into that, just to see how that whole type of situation is handled. As I mentioned a little earlier, we did have a rash, and we're having a rash of water main breaks. And over the holidays there, that week after the holiday, I believe we had 7 or 8 water main breaks. And I would just like to thank Jerry DeYoung, James Farrell, Jason McManus, and John Kine, who make up our DPS department, for all the hard work that they did with that. And finally, I just like to say, we have about, for the people that are out in television land, we have about eight people, residents here, who are here to just see the meeting. I would encourage all of you at some time to come down, sit in on a meeting, and get a real feel for what's happening in your community. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bellamy. Mr. Ballesto.
I'd like to ask Chief Hurdock to come up and perhaps go over the total number of fire and emergency calls for the year of 2012. I know that the last meeting I made mention of the fact that while we were all home over the Christmas holidays, sleeping snug in our beds, the volunteer firemen and rescue service would be out making calls, and they certainly did. Numerous calls on a number of nights, where they barely got home, got to back to bed, and another call came out. But perhaps Chief Murdoch could just elaborate a bit on that for us.
The fire department this year set a new record on total responses with fire and rescue to a tune of 611 responses. Last year there was 411 rescues, and this year we just about hit 500. So obviously from 411 to 500, we had a considerable increase in rescue. Fire stayed about the same.
So you're expecting an annual increase of about?
It's been running about 10% a year. This year was a little unusual, but we've already started off with a bang. I mean, our holiday season was pretty packed as well.
Yeah, we have a total of how many active volunteer firemen right now?
31.
So if you take that 600 and you add another 60 to it, 600, we're up to about 670, 672 calls projected for the coming year, and those firemen have to make an equal number of calls. They have a minimum that they have to make.
Yeah, they're required to make 30% of all fire, 30% of all rescue, and then 30% of all calls between 10 and 6 in the morning.
And you do have some members of the volunteer fire department that make almost 100% of the calls.
There's a good percentage of the department that are well over 50%. There's a bunch up in the 80, 90 mark, quite a few in the 70, but for the most part, most of the department's running over 50, 49 and then up. So it's quite a dedicated group.
Yeah, well, a big vote of gratitude to that group. They're very dedicated to what they do.
They're a great group of guys to work with, very dedicated to the community.
Thank you.
No problem.
And I'd also like to ask Kathy Walker to come up. Kathy is a passionate kayaker, and she's been working with Tim, and there's going to be an informational meeting at Centennial Farm in regards to kayaking.
that'll be coming up, and I'll let Kathy speak to it.
Thank you.
Because she's not prepared.
No, I was just going to do a little thing at the end. We've been talking about kayaking last year on Grove Seal just a little bit, and so I thought this year maybe we'd get it together and get it going and getting it organized and see if there's interest. I think there is. We have an informational meeting scheduled for February 4th at 7 p.m. at Centennial Farms. There'll be coffee. Everyone is welcome. We want people from off-island. It's in line with what Wally was saying earlier. We want people to know about Grove Seal. It's a great, you know, environment. Everybody should participate. It's probably more for 18-year-olds and above, but bring anybody you want. We've got a Facebook page going. I'm starting that up. We've got it on Grove Seal's Facebook. We've had a lot of likes already. People are interested, and it's for everybody. All skill levels. We're partnering with RKC, Riverside Kayaking Connection. We've done a little promo to talk about. Come on down. Everybody's welcome. They're going to do a PowerPoint presentation. I'll be the moderator. Tim Rooney will be presenting. Just to tell you what we're doing, it'll be Tuesday nights. We're hoping, if there's interest, it'll be Tuesday nights out of Water's Edge. 6 o'clock to about 7:30. Come on down. There's parking. There's bathrooms. And they'll see people at no fee. We'll take you out and paddle around the island. If you want a rental, they can arrange that, and that's their thing. But bring your kayak, bring your enthusiasm, and we're here for you. So I hope everyone comes down. Again, it's Monday, February 4th at 7 p.m. at Centennial Farm. We'll have coffee, maybe cookies, who knows, maybe some chocolates.
Okay. Ken was one of those people that started out with one of the big box store kayaks and realized that it wasn't all that great. So she went out and bought herself a GoFaster kayak.
I got pretty.
And it pretty, yeah, exactly. And she's pretty passionate about the activity. And this would be another great way of blending Grove Seal into surrounding communities in an activity where kayaking can be a solo activity, and what many people would like that. It's also a group activity, and it could draw a lot of people to the downriver area based on combining different communities and putting activities together to draw people in. And again, it's a good way of showing just how pretty, you know, how beautiful Grove Seal is from the water.
It's wonderful. We've been doing it a lot at Grove Seal Yacht Club. They have it on Thursday nights for members. But this is for the community. This is for public. And there are so many canals here. There's so many waterways. And the people from Riverside Kayaking, Tiffany, the editor, she will take you around. They will never leave you. If something goes wrong, if you don't feel comfortable, they will paddle back with you, and which is really nice. I've seen it happen. They make sure you're okay, and then they go back out. But there are always at least two people in the group so that you're safe. And again, it's at no fee. And I think that's just kind of really, it speaks well for us. And her husband happens to be a doctor, which is nice. He comes with us a lot. So they have a doctor there. She was an attorney. That's nice, too. And but the paddling is great, and it's for all skill levels. I didn't like my little, you know, kayak because it went too slow. And I don't like being the last one. So now I'm going to be right up there with the pack. So come on down, please. Bring your friend here. We're really going to have a nice event. We're hoping for at least 50 people. I know Otis told me we did this about 20 years ago. He told me he had a heck of a turnout. But, you know, why not? We've got it. We're talking about it. Let's do it. It's non-impact. It's great. You know, for women, you don't have to have a partner. You can come and meet friends. It's like, as Tom said, you can be do it by yourself or do it in a group, but it's very welcoming. At our club, it was just wonderful. Everybody helps each other. Even my husband, who does not do a lot, always was there. He does not participate, but he would help pick up the kayaks. So everybody helps each other. It's really very communal. It's very nice. It's a nice group. And then, of course, if you want to have some, you know, perhaps an adult beverage later or a sandwich, I think Sharkies would be happy to take care of you. So if you have any questions, come on out.
Thanks, Gabby.
Hope to see you, Tom.
You will. And thank you, Tim, as well. I'm done.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Walker. Thank you, Mr. Malvesto. Mr. Posias.
Well, with all of this activity
of physical fitness and promoting active communities, I want to talk about a chili and brownie contest for a moment. We have to sustain ourselves. On the 26th, there is a Knights of Columbus Chili and Brownie Contest that'll be held over at the VFW Hall, and starts at 6 o'clock. This is the eighth one we've done. We've had seven great successes. A lot of people go and have fun. They cook their own chili, they cook their own brownies. They're being there, and the audience does the judging. A great community event, very nutritious, only the best hot dogs, and the finest chili. And we even had some venison chili, some vegetarian chili, and we've had some chicken chili, and we've had some spirited competition. I think last year we had 19 entrants for the chili. So come on down. It's a $10 bill. It goes to charity. And we'd love to see you all there, getting physically fit with us. That's the end of my report. It's in the real camera. It's in the real zeal. I think Lena has come across with the real camera and done, again, a nice promotion job for us. It should be on Grizzly TV right now. And there's a lot of people with a lot of bragging rights. So if you think you've got good chili, bring it on.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Posias. Ms. Smith.
Okay. I want to thank the Grimsby Hill Police and Fire for rescuing the deer. That was a great story. Love to see that on the news. It's positive. I've got a couple things going on. Wednesday is a Communications Commission meeting, and we're changing for the Festival Commission meeting. That's going to be changed, so we're TBD right now. But on Wednesday, I'm actually heading up to East Lansing to Michigan State University to participate in their Institute for Public Policy. So basically, this is like an annual forum series, and it's free, so if anybody wants to join me at the future sessions, basically, it's a network of business leaders, policy advocates, and university faculty together to learn about policy-relevant research, exchange practical information, and cultivate possible solutions for new partnerships. So I'm kind of taking that on as some professional development. And then, let's see, next week we've got the Michigan Township Association's annual conference. So I'm looking forward to that. Going to probably learn a lot. Other than that, that's it.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Smith. Moving on to the supervisor's report, with a full month going by since meetings, I've got just a bunch of material to cover. Some of the things I've been working on, I've attended a couple meetings with local communities concerning a grade separation. That would be a road and a rail line separation on Allen Road, the ones we've all grown old at, read books, done crossword puzzles, wondering if the train, when it would go forward, stop, back up, etc., when that was going to ever let us get home. There was an earmark. It's right now it's in County Commissioner Ray Basham's district. There's a $9 million earmark that they would like to use, augmented with some untold number of millions, 10 to 20 more, to get it done. Funding, of course, is a concern, and I'm just going to throw out, somewhere I'll try to get a feel of this community's pulse on, would you be willing to join a regional tax authority? It consists of five communities. We'd be one of the five. I don't know how the cost would be apportioned. Again, this is all very preliminary, but they were looking at a possible regional taxing authority, much like a DDA or something along those lines. Five communities, Woodhaven, Brownstown, Gibraltar, Gros Hill, and Trenton, would be involved in this, and it would be to relieve the congestion on Allen Road where you get stopped forever. Different communities obviously have different levels of concern with that. We have alternate ways, so I will certainly not raise my hand and say Gros Hill is interested until I get a preponderance of evidence or support and a resolution from this board. So that's one of the things that's out there. Trenton has a little bit different ideas. The CN Railroad has different ideas. It would be a two-year project. Just have to look at it as life would be better when that's done, if it ever gets done. Additionally, from the city of Trenton, I still have no news to report on the McCaw plant. No matter how much I threaten or beg Jim Wagner, he will not tell me who's bidding interesting in the property. They're still optimistic that there will be a very positive result going on in what has been a long process.
And as soon as he tells me and tells me I can tell you, I will let you know what's happening. Commissions, committees, those of you out there, we need your vote to select your chairs so that they can all be reappointed at the township meeting. So at your next meetings, next opportunities, let's get the vote on your chairs and get those recorded votes to the clerk's office to be recorded and moved on to the annual meeting. Another communication item we're looking at, and this just came up again, as we're looking at additional ways to get information to you, the residents, and it came up again because I was reminded of it on the Nixle program. It's very similar to a Twitter. It's a one-way information, and it allows public safety or administrators to get messages out to the subscribers. It works very well in the city of Dearborn. I was reminded of it because a guy who works in Dearborn said, you know, he gets notified when a road is closed, when there's going to be a funeral, something that's going to impact him getting to or from work. And we can do the same things here. I just think it'd be wonderful, someone coming back from across town, if we could notify them that the county bridge was closed for a couple hours, or there was a broken train across Allen Road. We could get that information to your smartphone, and you could make alternate plans according. I think it'd be a wonderful service to get out. Additionally, Amber Alerts, fires, power outages, just a great avenue of information. So Mr. Fournier had established that account a couple of years ago. We kind of let it go fallow, but we'll be working on that and get a good product. It will require you to sign up for it, but the big advantage, I think, first of all, it's instantaneous. It costs nothing, and hopefully we can get away from first call as much as possible. That's it's an option we still use. It's expensive. I think first call is expensive. And as more people move away from landline phones and are all solely relying on cell phones, preponderance now are smartphones, there's the capability to contact you with the information we think you need, or your public safety would need. So it's just a great opportunity, something we'll be working on in the foreseeable future. Speaking of which, Fort Street will be closed northbound in Riverview, and I've got a bunch of notices in the back. Try to get you updated on all of them. But yeah, the MDOT press release, and it's going to be January 7th. It'll be for this coming weekend, the 19th through the 22nd. It's supposed to end by the Tuesday, the 22nd. All northbound traffic, and it sounds like between King and Eureka will be closed, so plan accordingly. If you can find another way to go other than Fort Street, please take that into account. That's from MDOT, and there's a flyer on the little console there in the back of the room. Other odds and ends that Carol thought you might find interesting, some income tax changes. This is from the IRS. These are all in the back of the room if you want to pick one up on the way out. DCC's Energy Assistance Program, 2013 Energy Assistance Program. There is a proof of household income. The thresholds are on the back. I'm tired of reading threshold numbers. So if you think you qualify, pick up one of these. If you don't have one, we'll try to get one on the website, or you can pick one up at the township offices at the administration desk. And Grosseal Township offices will be closed on Monday, January 21st, 2013, honor the Martin Luther King Jr. Day holiday. Of course, reopening again Tuesday morning at 8 o'clock. That's it for the media events. We'll be meeting again in 2 weeks. I have no further. That concludes my supervisor's report. So we will move on to Township Manager's report, Mr. William.
With your permission, I'll skip that important right to the discussion item.
I cover everything for you?
Township currently has on our records the Boca property maintenance code. We need to do some housekeeping. Boca joined the ICC, which is the International Code Council. So we need to do some adjustments to our township ordinances, and I wanted just to take the opportunity to discuss that with the board tonight rather than just bring an amendment forward. The conversation started over the past several months where we want to basically try to address the property maintenance issues that we've been confronted with, mostly grass, guards, things like that, some of the stuff people refer to as blight. I included our township nuisance ordinance in the background package that is on the books and will continue to be on the books. But when it comes to what the building codes are and all the structural items, those are already part of the actual building code which we've adopted. But the property maintenance, we need to make adjustments because Boca did join the ICC. So we've been reviewing this document, and all the others, I've already sent it on to the other inspectors, and we'll be bringing forward to the board an updated version and with all the updates and proper references. So that's the general thumbnail sketch of where we are and what we're addressing. And if Mr. Sori, if you care to add, I ask that you do so.
As the township manager indicated, we've kind of gone through the ordinances, and this is the one that we've identified. I think we brought it up to you a little before, actually. In going through the code, our current ordinances, we've established that the property maintenance code was the last adapted in 1996. So with everyone going to the ICC in 98, it's been that long, sorry. So the international property code that we're looking at, which is the current version, which is 2009, essentially is the same as what we have in the books now. There's just the interaction and the reference to the building code, the fire code, the plumbing code, the electrical code. The current versions, this would more closely resemble those codes and interact closer with those. It would enhance, we already do have the ordinances on the books for nuisances that addresses everything. The current code that we have is effective and can be adopted. It's the township's prerogative to adopt a property maintenance code if they so choose. They don't have to adopt a property maintenance code. We can adopt one that we draft completely on our own. We don't have to adopt one at all. Most communities in Southeast Michigan adopted the Boca property maintenance code. And with Boca going to ICC in 98, after the 96 version, pretty much everything is at the ICC level now. So our hope was just to catch up with that so that we've got the books, and you know, the books are up to date and what we've got. Nothing major.
So it wouldn't take a major change. We wouldn't have the planning commission working for weeks, tweaking our current, the blight ordinances, the other storage, etc. ordinances.
All those ordinances would remain in effect. Our nuisance ordinance and our blight ordinances, everything we have in the books remain in effect. The maintenance code is an additional provision that gives another hearing system to afford the property owner the opportunity to go through proper means, make sure that they have their rights are protected as far as hearings are concerned, notice, all those types of things. So there would be no, you don't have to adopt anything at this point. Our suggestion, after working with the township manager, though, is that if we're going to keep the 96 property maintenance code in place, let's adopt the 2009, at least so the two, you know, the documents mesh with the building, the updated building code, electrical code, and plumbing code, which we've already adopted.
Okay. Mr. Trey,
what is the process that's going to bring this forward as action? Is there going to be a process? Is this going through the planning commission? Does it have steps that it has to before it comes back to us to put in real time?
No, it would be township board approval. I don't know to what level. I mean, it would be your prerogative if you chose to have the planning commission look at it. It's certainly something that you could have done, but I don't think there's...
I'm just wondering if there's maybe an opportunity here to, if there are some areas in our current codes or in the current Boca code. I mean, we all get complaints about one thing or another, and sometimes we generate them ourselves. It would just be an opportunity to improve that condition. I know it's not going to improve the enforcement end of it, but actually the code end of it. And if that's the case, should it not go through the planning commission or someone like that?
Well, at this point in time, I've sent it to the inspectors, our part-time folks, the plumbing, mechanical, electrical, heating, as well as our actual building inspector, and asked them to take a look at this document. And as Mr. Sorti had said, from the building code standpoint, we've already adopted all the ICC updates.
Sure.
So
I'm not so concerned to the construction code level.
Right.
As I am the property, by its very name, property maintenance level of it. And is that something that is addressed? Now, I read through most of the stack. It's a big order. And I read through most of it. There are some areas that we are really missing in our ordinances. And if we were to adapt that, then it might save us going through our ordinances and changing a bunch of those. Is this the time to do that or not?
I guess it would depend on what sections of the ordinances there are, because certain, if it were a zoning ordinance, then there's a hearing process that's different than adopting this as a...
Well, this isn't zoning. Yeah. I'm really talking Correct. About point. Mm-hmm. Those issues, maintenance. Yeah. Don't forget, as this indicates, maintenance.
Don't forget, we already have the 96 OPEC property maintenance code on the books, which is still current and effective law and completely enforceable.
Sure.
This is just essentially an update on the language.
I think I would encourage the board to get a copy of this. It's on the, you sent it to us.
Right.
We have it all. Mm-hmm. It's several pages, 50 pages, 60 pages. I took the time to print it off. And see if there's anything in it that you would want to single out. There are a number of areas that I have, but
there are a few areas that require insertions by the township once they're adapted. Sure. For instance, at what height level they want grass.
Sure.
To, you know, those types of things. So that would be something that we would continue to work on. I think the intent of tonight's was to get in front of you to say, here's what we're looking at, and we're going to continue to work on.
Sure. Okay. I just see it as it's a maintenance code as an opportunity, because we get a lot of complaints throughout the township on a regular basis about some of the issues that may or may not be addressed. I just wonder if this is an opportunity to look over that, or do we need to literally go through our code book and make the changes as a board?
I would like to, I agree that this is an opportunity. If we're going to adopt this, let's get everything in sync. Let's make the changes we know we need to make, get it done at once, and get to work.
There may not be changes in here that we don't even know we need to make.
Sure. I guess I would propose that administratively we'll put together a draft, and just so we're not constantly waiting for meetings, then send it on to the board, along with we'll distribute the entire
that makes sense.
The iron packet with areas and sections and questions I'll highlight and mark up and send that on. So we have constant input coming our way and internal discussion.
And maybe a great tool for us at this point.
Okay.
And if we're going to do it, and if it takes a month longer to do it right, then I think we should probably look into that.
Yeah, so I think Mr. Gannon has this correctly. If I look through this, actually most of this is not really the purview of the Planning Commission per se.
Yeah.
And most of this is municipal code, it's building code, it's not Planning Commission code. Planning Commission would be happy to look through some of the stuff if the board so chooses to have us do, and I'm sure our planners would be happy to do that as well. But most of this is board level municipal code.
Other questions, comments for Mr. Sorter?
Okay,
this, well, let's move on to...
Oh,
sure, Mr. Ranta.
Thank you, Mr. Supervisor. So the title is Proposed Paperless Board Packets and Township Board Tablet Computers. So right after the election, I sat down at the clerk's office and you know, asked a couple questions, basically, you know, three questions that I do, you know, if there's any kind of a change in my work environment. And that's, number one is what do you want to see more of? What do you want to see less of? And then what has to stop altogether? So one of the things that came out of that was the amount of time that it takes to put together the board packages. And Ted Fournier also indicated that he would see a potential big cost savings. So we did the math on it. And the board packages, just by a high-level estimate, cost us about $1,500 a year. So there's a significant amount of money that we can save if we go to paperless packages. That coupled with the fact that we really need to get a better handle on our email communication. So emails for the township elected officials are really their own emails that are then archived through the township, but they're not run through the township computer servers. And I really think that that needs to change as we go forward. So if you put those two ideas together, the paperless packages and the email archiving, you can really pay for the email archiving with going to paperless packages. And there's a number of documents that are in our packages tonight. From a discussion standpoint, I really just want to get a feel from the board whether this is something that we want to pursue or whether we don't want to pursue it. Right? Are you in love with your paper packages? And are you in love with having anyone pick them up, or would you like to be able to wirelessly download those at your convenience? So really there's no prepared discussion. I just would like to get a little feedback from the board, and then also let the board know that it's something that the clerk's office is looking at as basically, you know, an improvement to the process that the clerk's office has to go through on a bi-weekly basis, and then also from a document retention standpoint, getting more in line with the, you know, the relevance of email and the use of email.
I was, Mrs. Walker, once again, she took the lead on a portion of this. We have representatives from Granicus who provide the archive videos, which I think is a wonderful tool. I wish I looked better, but I think it's just a great tool. All our board meetings are now available to the public, the time of the meeting, thereafter, and in perpetuity. But they also offered a paperless tablet-based packet, but theirs was limited now to Apple products, and I'm real hesitant to get the township married to Apple. Some people love them, some people hate them, but you know, some people used to like the Sony Betamax, and once you get locked into that piece of technology, you're just stuck with it. I just don't like that everything on Apple is proprietary. But the first thing I said to him was, when you have an Android program, come back and talk to us. So it's out. That's the industry standard, and that's where much of the development's going. The cost of the tablets, the reliability of the tablets, things will sort out, I suppose. It's not like tablets are new technology. The prices have plummeted on them since the Android versions of the iPad, Pod, something. Anyway, is an opportunity. How robust is the system? You know, this is all one part of the equation. Do we want to go to that? We know these are going to need replacement at some point. They're pretty much steam-driven old CRTs. We'd certainly have a lot more capabilities for interactive presentations. You could see what we saw. People at home could see it. We could, again, have interactive presentations here. We've got two huge monitors. We could bring everybody on board. I think it's a wonderful opportunity. The email thing is a separate question. It would be somewhat divorced from the tablets, but we need to go beyond. We have no archiving capability now. We need to address that. We're going to stay ahead of the retention requirements. And as we said, you know, as we get into budgeting, we'll figure out what we need to get us moving in the right direction on that. I don't know if anybody here in their other way of life uses computers, laptops, pads, pods. General Airways replaced much of their paperwork with tablets.
FedEx was talking about doing it, but it's going to happen next week, and we heard that for about 4 years, and it just quietly died. I don't know, see if I know anybody at JetBlue anymore and see how it's worked out, because that's a pretty harsh environment. If their tablets held up through that, I think we could be trusted to get at least a year's life out of it anyway. So if anybody knows of an organization that is using these in place of paperwork, let us know. We'll see what works and what doesn't. I'm seeing that, and nobody's raising their hand. Mr. Van Ass.
I just, one comment, you made a comment. If anybody types into the paper, I get sick of carrying it to the shredder. And the less amount of paper you can put on my desk, the happier you're going to make me. In any way, shape, or form. I'm not an expert, don't profess to be an expert, but I'm teachable, like a monkey on a tree, maybe. You give me a piece of equipment that's going to reduce the paper flow in this township, and I'm looking at thousands of dollars worth of savings, just in paper.
Yeah.
I mean, we go through so much paper in this township, and I would be all for anything that you as an expert or your experts, your trained experts, will bring forward, I would be all for it.
Other comments? Hey, it's your turn, Eric. I'm sorry.
No, that's fine. I mean, this is discussion, so I would like to hear from everyone.
Yeah, Eric, as much as I am an old traditionalist and prefer to read from paper, I mean, it's just the way to the future. And it is more efficient, I think. And I think we have to look at that, and I probably right behind Ted on the monkey tree, but I am trainable, and I just think we have to go that way.
So my two-year-old picks up our tablet and can turn it on and off and navigate to wherever he wants to go. I think all of us here are capable of doing the same.
I love the idea. I mean, I've got my iPad right here. It's time. That's all I've said. Time.
Mr. Chair, the university has a computer and information technology department, and I do have some access to it. If this commission would like us, or if this board would like to see some assistance from that end, I think I could get that. And we're highly computerized at the school. Everything is done on computer, paperless, as much as possible. I can tell you where 2 ounces of a chemical disposed of 3 years ago can come and can detect it within seconds. So the advantage of going paperless and the advantage of going to this system is, let your imagination be your guide. It's a good thing, and I can ride the jet. I don't know how to build one, but I can ride the jet, and I too can be trained.
Tom, any feedback?
I'm totally in favor of it, so you need my support.
Okay. Well, again, so the discussion item, it sounds like there's support. It sounds like there's some questions specifically about what architecture we go with, what software, and what devices, which clearly is going to be, you know, it's going to take some time and some thinking to get the best cost value benefit. Again, this is a summary. I think it's definitely a cost save for us, and it's an improvement for the efficiency of at least the clerk's office from a standpoint of email archiving, and then also from a standpoint of making the packages. It's 15 packets per week, and roughly each packet's around $5 when you include all the copy costs, let alone any of the extracurricular stuff. And if there's color copies in there, it grows exponentially. So I think there's value in doing it, and we will look forward to putting together some more details and then putting together some budget and cost-saving numbers for the annual budget process. So thanks for the input.
Very good. This is exciting. I'm charging into the 21st century. That concludes.
Charging.
Thanks. Either way, everyone's the same. That will conclude our two discussion items. I think they're both very positive steps to move us along. Now I'll open it up to extended public comment. We're going to stick with the 3 minutes. Please introduce yourself to the deputy clerk with your name and address. And at this time, the floor, Mr. Clark.
Good
Woody Clark, Park Lane. Legal fees?
There's legal fees on the warrant list dated 12/18/2012 to O'Reilly Rinciano in the amount of $4,101.
Is it? Okay. You have agenda 21. Obama signed an executive order 13575. You have agenda 21 has been out there for a long, long time. So you give me out there a promise line, I want to go to the search engine, put it, you have agenda 21, we'll find all about it. Pentagon and Theodore, when are they going to do anything, or when is Wayne County going to get out the dime? Anything?
Horsemail, you mean horsemail?
Horsemail, I mean, I'm sorry. I apologize.
Mr. Chair?
Mr. President?
That committee is meeting and has, in fact, got budgetary information into the county. We are aiming for construction in this year.
This year?
That's
what we're talking about. So this year is going to be like 5 years.
Well, I think we're
I mean, I'm talking about, you know, they always say Wayne County. Wayne County's over there.
Well, Wayne County does hold things up, but they hold things up for a reason. And I think we've gotten some questions answered. I know that Dale's worked with the commission members to iron out some path width issues and try to obtain some additional funding so that we can afford a more complete and thorough bike path than what the budget was going to allow originally. And more to come. And if you show up tomorrow night, maybe you could ask a few more questions.
Okay, what are we on the light?
We have some.
No, we have some light. We got light, more light out there.
You just saw this, I think, the last step before we start the education program. So we get ensure that our property maintenance light ordinances are all in line with the ICC, the new property maintenance code, and we have a start point. I think we've gotten the feedback from the community. The preponderance of the community is interested in cleaning up those, I would just say, eyesores, the blight. We have our ordinances. Our ordinance will presumably be in line with the ICC now, and I think we'll be in the position to legally and properly go forward.
And when will that be?
Well, let's get this ICC adopted and ensure that our township ordinances are aligned with that. If we have to tweak something, we'll do that. And then probably hold another open house, explain to the residents, here's where we are, here's where we want to go, and begin with an education program. And I've said this before, I'm confident that education will clear up 95% of the problems. Notification should clean up most of the rest of it, and if we have to go into enforcement, we go into enforcement. But I think education, 95% of the people will comply.
Okay.
I'm hoping.
It doesn't matter if the guy moves it once, twice, three times, six times, 40 times. It's the ones that's been sitting there that have not moved at all. Some for 10 years, some for 15 years. And they just sit there and never go anywhere. Okay, I'm going to wake Jerry up now. A police officer can't pull you out of refuge just because you give him a finger. A federal appeals court delivered Thursday. And a 14-day detention in the U.S. Court of Appeals by the Second Court said the court ruled the agent gesture of insult was not the basis of a reasonable suspicion of a traffic violation and impending criminal.
Does anybody want to top that one?
I just want to know which finger.
So just as a reference, it's not a Rosie old case.
Yeah.
Woody can always leave us laughing.
Hi, Mrs. Walker. Top that.
This is serious. In response to Mr. Supervisor, what you said about the Nextel, I spoke with Ken Fournier the other day when we were doing our promo, and he's very excited to do that. And when you said you wanted to have participants, we had 517 Facebooks on the township.
perhaps we could invite them to go to this, and that would be an instant population for you. And also we can do a flyer to notify people who are not on Facebook. And secondly, since I wasn't prepared earlier, Mr. Maldasso, the Ill Camera has been helping us in this. Lena has been wonderful, as always. They had a little article last week on News and Brief and a letter to the editor. The News Herald has interviewed me, and that will be so that we'll be reaching out beyond the island to get participants. Also, I will be contacting the News and the Free Press. So we are moving forward quite a bit on that, and like I said, I didn't expect to talk to them. And lastly, with the tablets, Ted Fournier has been working on this for a number of years, and he's really going to be excited when I talk to him about this on Wednesday night, because he wanted to see the paper list, and he's been urging the Communication Commission for years to lobby the board, and this is just wonderful to hear that you guys, because when you do pass things on, you can just hand it to each other, and you don't have to lose any of the emails. So this is very exciting for the Communication Commission, and I thank you.
You're going to be busy.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Walker. Mr. Acker?
No, just add on it. Ted was a big push behind it.
Good. I'm still in a good mood, though. What the heck? Here we are. Mr. Zalasco.
Kathy, yes, we've been referred to as a gotcha.
With reference to the comments made by Mr. Van Oss and Mr. Budney on the rash of water breaks, a week ago on a cold, blustery Sunday morning, the subdivision that I reside in experienced one of those. And I just want to take a moment to thank you fellows, Mr. Sedlock and his crew, on the expeditious manner in which you guys get on those things. It was a job well done. Well done. The downtime was minimal. Thank you very much. Thank you, Bob.
Okay, any other comments, questions from the public present? I see none offered. So at this time, I will entertain a motion to adjourn to closed session.
So moved.
Moved by Mr. President, seconded by Mr. Bundy. Those in favor of adjourning to closed session, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We stand adjourned from open session at 9:40.
Give us 5 minutes.
We're 5 minutes out of time.
Say what?